Well, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I will take permission once again to stand on the protocols. With the exception of our great outgoing group managing director, NFDC, Dr. Mackenzie Barrow, who we all have to commend for having performed the last couple of years in a sterling fashion as a leader of our industry and has handed over to one of our own. Now, I say one of our own because in Nigeria, you have to be a youth, you have to be at least 50 years old. And then, if you're in a challenging industry like oil, you would typically have lost most of your hair by the time you achieve a position of leadership. And Medicare is an incredibly astute oil executive, one of our own, and we can't thank GMD enough in identifying this sheer talent in the industry and choosing somebody who, unfortunately for us, is probably a harder negotiator than GMD. As you would realize, GMD is a doctor. Means he has a PhD, so he's very well studied, and whenever you negotiate with him, you never quite achieve sort of the terms you're looking for. He frowns all through the negotiation, and then when you're about to walk out of the door, he will smile like you, look at you cheekily and say, okay, we'll give you 2% off. Well, unfortunately, Kieran is the exact opposite. He always sounds sweet all through the negotiation. He acts like he's doing you a favor, but by the time you walk out of the door, you realize you lost money. So sometimes I worry what succession is doing for us in the industry. So, ladies and gentlemen, we've been prepared for a tough 4 years. Talking about tough years, I was asked to speak on challenges in the oil industry, our personal experiences, and I think that the oil industry is probably a company that has set out to do great things, has won in a lot, has failed in a few, but no matter what, is resilient and will continue to soldier on irrespective of the odds to create, to be true to the vision it had, which was to be a world-class company. And I think when we first started, we wanted to be not just world-class, but indigenous, and we wanted to apply global standards in everything we did. And I still remember in the early days, 25 years ago when we started the company, of people laughing at us saying, who do they think they are? They want to be Shell. What's all this process, procedure that they have internally? But at the end of the day, we came to realize that in order to be a partner of choice for those who would invariably finance you, global financial institutions, who would partner you, counterparties, international counterparties, and to be able to execute and succeed in this extremely challenging terrain, you do definitely have to be best in class or attempt to be best in class in everything you do. I think that we started out as a trading company and in 1994, coalition or not, and we had a lot of support from the NMDC. So once again, indigenous players, there's no indigenous company that doesn't have their origins, their history, their support base in the national oil company. The national oil company has done a fantastic job in supporting and creating us. We got credit from them, we got opportunities to do business with them, and they supported us all through. I even remember one of the earlier transactions we did, which was when typically the golden age of the industry, when all the refineries worked full capacity, the pipelines was in the 90s, and we had an opportunity of doing something. The refineries worked so well in Kaduna Refinery that we had excess LRS, which is long residue, straight from fuel, and we were able to. We secured a very innovative solution which we brought for the rather than refinery shutting down for X number of months or weeks. We were lifted by truck. We used to truck 100 trucks a day down south. We had no storage terminals in the ports as we have today because all the pipelines were. So we had to use vegetable oil tanks to store the fuel, okay, into up to 8,000 tonnes. And we used to re-export it to Lume, build it into 50,000 tonnes and then ship it Corpus Christi for your refineries to use as a feedstock. These were amongst the more interesting things we did in the early days. In 2000, we had an opportunity of participating in the privatization. It was an NNPC company called Unipetrol, which is Esso's former downstream assets, which we were able to acquire a 30% stake in. In 2002, we acquired IGIP's downstream operation. Our drive then was to be the leading downstream player. That was our plan. And we were able to achieve that by 2004. We had number one in terms of market distribution in the retail industry. I think that we branched out towards doing infrastructure opportunities, and once again with the NNPC, we built the first gas distribution network in Lagos. And it was called GasLink. That was an NGC concession, which we were able to negotiate and create a concession. The NNPC had never done it before. We were able to create from scratch a concession, which we took project risk, financing risk, and NNPC gave us the gas on credit. And today we have 130 industries taking gas today from us. And we've been able to drop by at least 40% the cost of power to those industries and stimulate economic growth. We did other projects, for example, we've done a similar thing in Port Harcourt. We did another 250-kilometer pipeline in the east in the Calabar region, and we went on to do other infrastructural projects, for example, a midstream jetty, which was done towards reducing over $50 million a year demurrage, which is currently being experienced in our industry. In terms of our evolution, we haven't focused on infrastructure projects. We had challenges in terms of looking at the downstream industry and looking at the margins. The margins were 10% when we first started in the downstream in 2000, gross margins. Gross margins today have dropped to as little as 3-4% because the government has chosen to effectively subsidize the price as a social palliative. Not that I support it, because I think we spent $5 billion last year on subsidies, and we spent more money on subsidies than we did on health, education, and housing combined. At the end of the day, at a growth rate of 3%, the population of this country, 3-5%, is literally doubling every 20 years. So the question is, what is the best investment? Investing in infrastructure or investing in consumption? There's a big debate that has to be made, and I think the oil industry absolutely needs to challenge, to champion that debate with the federal government. The politicians want to win votes at all costs, but there's a long-term damage that we're doing to our country, there's a long-term damage we're doing to our industry that must be championed. Because we do need to ensure that these subsidies are halted, the downstream needs to be commercialized, the refineries need to function, the pipelines need to function. There's no logic in us transporting all the products we can do by road, okay, at an extremely expensive rate without the chance to build the multiplier effect of having a vibrant downstream. So one of the key takeaways from this conference, I would say, is for the industry itself to have more of a voice in these matters rather than accepting what is thrust onto it by the politics of the day. We do have a voice, and we do need to be heard. I think that one of the key things which we did as we evolved, we went into the upstream industry in 2005 after we listed, and we did a cross-border listing on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. We were able to create a platform to raise equity, and we raised a substantial amount of equity, even at the height of the crash in 2008. We were able, in 2006, we raised $100 million, which was the highest, largest amount ever raised by a Nigerian public company then. And in 2008, at the height of the crash, we were able to raise another $100 million from the US investors to come into the Nigerian market through Oanzo and take some of the opportunities. We went into the upstream, and we were a 5,000 barrel a day producer of the marginal fields. And the most capacity defining transaction we did was the approximately $1.8 billion, including adjustments, acquisition of Conoco's business in Nigeria, which was a 20% stake in the now joint venture, which was a significant transaction for us. It was extremely challenging in the sense that we had to pay a non-refundable deposit of $500 million to get into the party, which we did, and then we now had to worry about raising the rest of the capital within the time frame. We had delays, regulatory delays over close to 18 months in getting the consent, because there were a lot of challenges which we had in securing that consent from the ministry, as it then was. even though we're an indigenous company. Eventually, we closed the transaction. We borrowed $800 million, and we had $800 million in equity, so it was worth $1,600 million, which we parted with cash. Of course, there was some adjustments of $200 million in working capital adjustment, which made the headline number to be $1.8 billion, but the actual cash that we parted with was $1.6 billion. Extremely challenging transaction. The good news, though, is, or the bad news then, was not only was it a very expensive transaction then, because the crude oil price was $112 when we closed, then the crude oil price within July when we closed, and by December, the crude oil price had dropped to $60 a barrel, okay? And 1 year after the acquisition, the crude oil price had dropped to $30 a barrel. So you can imagine the luck of Orlando signing the biggest check of his life, and then the market doing a complete reverse. And that was also coupled with the time when there was a lot of Niger Delta militancy, production was severely hampered, there was flooding as well. We have a big swamp operation, and a lot of the pipelines were affected by the flooding. We had to reduce production. So effectively, we had a big restructuring to achieve. Then and there, we took a decision immediately towards being able to right the challenges which we saw, which was in our business, and we had key decisions to take. So from experiences, we were able to immediately resolve, first and foremost, to reduce the overall footprint size of our business. We looked at our whole portfolio and decided that the returns on the downstream were challenged. With downstream, we had the subsidies and the regulation, high inflation, low returns, okay? We had devaluation, as we realized. We had a devaluation from 120 to 1 to the 360 we knew it as well. So we took some specific decisions, and one of the things we did was divest from the Naira earning downstream distribution businesses and focus on the upstream dollar earning export related businesses. And we did so. We did a divestment of our rig. We had a rig fleet, $400 million company. We divested our rig business. We had some debt notes which we converted very quickly. We divested a substantial interest in our downstream business. We brought on the world's largest commodities trader, Vitol, joined us. The largest private equity firm, Helios, joined us. At a time when exchange rates were plummeting, also at a time when the industry margins, there's a lot more volatility, which speaks to the quality of the businesses that, irrespective of the macro challenges the country was facing, the industry was facing, we still had off-takers who joined us in those ventures. We also did the same thing with our gas business, which has been, the local gas distribution business has been rebranded and is now called Exela today. Out of this, we were able to reduce our overall debt from $2.5 billion to $500 million in the last 3 years of operation. And incidentally, of the $800 million we borrowed from the ConocoPhillips acquisition, we paid $700 million off already. We're left really with $100 million, which we will certainly pay off over the next 12 months, paying an average of $25 million on a quarterly basis. So the reality is that what was hitherto a very challenging operation, we've been able to manage. We hedged at $95 a barrel. We sold forward when we did the first transaction, and that allowed us to recoup a higher oil price. And I must tell our indigenous colleagues that you must have a very, very aggressive hedging strategy when you buy these assets from the IOC. The IOC sold us these assets at top prices. And so what I think about it, I think Nigeria made a mistake not allowing the NNPC to sell down their interests in those joint ventures for the top prices the IOC's got. The IOC's got value, over $10 billion of value was extracted from Nigerian indigenous players, from Nigerian banks, and all that capital ended up abroad. Most of those loans are underwater today and are struggling to be serviced. A few of those loans have been successful. So I think that in looking forward, now that the federal government has resolved to sell down some of its interests in the joint ventures, we do need to ensure that Nigeria doesn't lose the opportunity a second time, because the indigenous players want to grow, and they will grow, and if the acreage is only available from the IOCs, they will back the IOCs. But then that's capital flight, money goes abroad, okay? We should take the opportunity of extracting that value and keeping the capital within our own environment. Today, we have an asset portfolio that our business is 90% upstream today. We have an asset portfolio that has close to 480 million barrels of reserves for the 3,000 barrels of production. We have great partners in the offshore, in South Tomé, Príncipe, EEZ. We have Cosmos. We have 131, 145 with ExxonMobil. We have the now joint venture with ENI, as well as certain margin of those which we operate. Now the question is, you know, what have we learned in the process? I think one of the key lessons we have learned in terms of managing challenges is to never confuse a clear line of vision with a straight line of execution. If there ever are going to be curveballs thrown at you in Nigeria, we'll throw them at you. And you've got to be prepared to be innovative, you've got to be prepared to be quick off your feet, you've got to be prepared to execute, okay, and to be resilient in the way and manner you execute your strategies. When I look at what we acquired, the downstream companies, and Unipetrol and Hygiene, the margins were 10%. So you can imagine our only priority was growth. Grow. Once you grow, you get 10% margins. The 10% margins, if you do $5 billion turnover, it's a $500 million in gross margins. But what we never realized was that deregulation would not occur, even though deregulation was said repeatedly as being the mantra of the oil policy of the country. Similarly, we had PIB. PIB started when General Obasanjo was president of Nigeria. That's 8 years ago, I think. Sorry, 16 years ago, right? We're still dealing with the PIB. So the question is, if you were writing a business plan based on PIB pronouncements, then you would have you would retire before your business plan even starts. So there would always be challenges in that nature. Who would have known that the refining industry would be so challenging that we have them today, 20 years after. In the 90s, when I first started business, we exported so much oil out of Nigeria as indigenous players. In fact, the exports were handled in Lagos by a sales manager. I never saw the MD of BPMC. I never saw the GMD. I didn't know who they were. But I was able to build a sizable business, okay, dealing with the corporation. So I think it's key to ensure that you always have the flexibility of understanding that your business plan will be effective. I think that financing is key. A lot of indigenous players have focused on debt, and debt is good when it's available. And when there's a lot of liquidity, you get a chance for a lot of liquidity. But there's always a day of reckoning when you have to pay that money back. Right? And paying that money back is extremely painful. So invariably, you will work for financial institutions, you will not work for shareholders. Okay? We went through that over a long period of time in terms of having taken on, you know, massive amounts of debt, built a very large corporation, midstream, downstream, upstream, a clear, integrated play, but eventually realizing that we didn't return as much as we would have liked to shareholders. We effectively worked for financial institutions, but we built a lot of infrastructure for the country, which we're very proud of today. And I see it as a national appointment. After all, we are an indigenous company, and we're here to stay. I think that in terms of managing your business, you need, as an indigenous company, you need to be focused on returns, you need to be disciplined, you need to be focused on cash flow. It's very, very important not to be carried away by the opportunity. Most indigenous players have simply taken what is available to them, okay, to get into the oil sector. Okay, at the end of the day, there's been a lot of work and support, particularly from the Nigerian Local Content Board, and when I look at the last 20 years, how much indigenous participation there is in the industry, it's overwhelming, the amount of support which we have received. And local content existed even before the law codified it. Before the final local content law was signed by designing Anderson Maizik as a minister, local content was actually being practiced every day by the NNPC. So the point I'm trying to make is that we do not need laws or regulations to do things. The collective goodwill of the industry is enough to be able to drive positive things forward in the industry. I would say that one, finally, or second to the last, is oil is a commodity. That may sound like a dumb, stupid thing to say, but the reality is it's going to go up in price, it's going to come down in price. Maybe in our situation as a new company, we are not seeing the cycles which, of course, the multinationals who have had 200 years of history of running oil and gas companies that have seen. So it's very important to understand that you have to invest when the price is low, and you have to reap the benefit when the price is high, and not do the opposite. Okay? By investing when the price is high, when the cycles change, you will be in trouble. And that's one of the key things which we all did. We all bought assets at the height of the market. Right? Okay, we spent $10 to $15 billion at the height of the market. $100 crude was where we closed. Well, today, $64. And the only reason why crude oil still stays at $64, let's be honest, is that even though there's been a lot of decline, there hasn't been much capital expenditure in the last 2, 3 years, 4 years by the majors. There's been natural decline, maybe 3 to 5% on average. But the shale industry has picked up, and you've seen production go from 5 million to 12 million barrels a day in the US in the last 10 years. Okay. Now, even with all the tension, or the geopolitical tension with Iran, the Middle East, and the Yemen and the activity, the oil price is at $65. So in reality, there's probably $10 of free oil price that is there. Maybe the real price for the commodity is $55 a barrel, which basically means that we, the indigenous companies, need to be doing transactions now. We don't need to wait until the price peaks again. And we do need to get active, not just with the NNPC, but with our IOCs, because the truth of the matter is that the IOCs, in my opinion, they have no reason to be onshore. They have wonderful capital budgets, they have first-class technology. They need to go develop the offshore and allow the IOCs as well, but this time the indigenous oil companies, access to that acreage onshore, where we will do a better job with the communities, we'll do a better job in ensuring that we mine the oil that is there, because we will not forsake the reserves and the size of the reserves or the size of opportunities which the thresholds of the majors do not accept. Finally, I would say that to the government, I would really encourage our government to embrace the public-private sector partnerships the most. Particularly in areas like the refineries. I think if we've approached an issue and tried to fix an issue for 10 years or 20 years in one particular manner and it doesn't work, we do need to approach it. There's a lot of indigenous capacity, there's a lot of indigenous capital, which if pooled together can provide an immediate financing solution for the refineries. So I would really encourage the government to look towards creating a public sector participation. We are the ones who will benefit, the indigenous oil companies, as well as the indigenous populace of the country, if the refinery and the pipeline system is made to work. And it will also create a lot of employment for the country, a lot of opportunity for small, medium-sized players to get actively involved in pipeline repair, pipeline maintenance, surveillance, and for the refineries being able to contribute their quota. And finally, like I mentioned earlier, I would also use this opportunity to encourage the majors to have an active program of ensuring that those acreage which they hold onshore, okay, are placed with indigenous oil companies on better structured terms and conditions. So the days when we did deals which were, you know, you do the tender, the highest bidder got it, cash was paid upfront, okay, is you get a good price for one asset. But at the end of the day, you know, you have so much, okay, and most majors, 70% of their production comes from 30% of their onshore assets anyway. So the reality is that there is scope for optimization. And that optimization is best served by doing value-added deals with indigenous companies wherein you agree a value, okay, a portion of the cash is paid, and there's an earn-out over time, okay, which ensures that the major has security in the barrels, but the indigenous operator is able to put a reasonable amount of capital into the investment, okay, and make a return as well as, and then in the long term, the majors get the full value. Because then, instead of doing one deal every 10 years, you might as well do several deals, which are better structured and provide you with a better return. So I'm happy all the CEOs of all the majors are here in today's conference. Thank you, CWC, for giving us the opportunity of speaking to them all at the same time. And I look forward to very active next term with the new GM of NNPC, Mr. Kiari, and I'm sure he will deliver for us and take us to the next promised land, having received an excellent platform from the RBA GM, Dr.